Happy Sabbath, everyone.
Happy Sabbath.
Welcome, and let's say a prayer. Father, in Jesus' name, we come before your presence this Sabbath morning in this place that is called by your name. We want to thank you, King of Glory, for keeping us safe through yet another week and for allowing us to gather here in your name. We are so glad, Lord, that you've promised where two or three gather in your name, you are in the midst of them. So, King of Glory, we invite your presence to be with us. Even as we lift up our voices to give you glory and honor and praise, we pray that you'll accept our sacrifices, O Lord. Forgive us of our sins and grace us with your presence, we pray in your name. Amen. Psalms 100 says, make a joyful shout to the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. Amen. Call to worship. If we can all stand up and participate in the call to worship.
Church. It's great to see you this Sabbath day, and I would like you to turn to your neighbor in front, behind, on the side of you, and say, what a great day to worship with you today. Okay, you may be seated. I do have a couple of announcements to make. First thing is, I'd like to welcome our visitors. If you're visiting with us today, we're so glad that you're here and a part of our service. And that means a lot to us, and we appreciate that very much, that you would be here and come out. If you have not filled out a visitor's card in the past, we would appreciate you taking one in the back of the pew and filling it out and putting it in the offering plate, or give it to me later in the service. And so that would be really nice to do that. I have an item of business to take care of, and we missed it last week, and that is Bob Beggs. Second reading as a transfer of membership. And Bob, could you stand up for a second? Bob is a great guy, and he's been around here for well over a year, or maybe 2 years by now, or more. And he's quiet, but he really is a great guy. And so glad that you are transferring into our church, and we want to make it official today. And so is there a motion to accept Bob into our church membership? A motion, a second. All in favor say amen.
Amen.
Amen. That sounded pretty good, Bob. So you are now officially a member, And officially, we like to have you at the close of the service to stand by the door and to greet you as a bona fide member of our church. All right. We do have a short announcement about deaconesses meeting immediately after the service here in the sanctuary. If you would come up front, any deaconesses or junior deaconesses, please make your way up front after the service for a short meeting. We have coming up on the 19th is our church business meeting. And we wanted to make sure everything is right as possible, as good as possible. And so that we're planning on this next Sunday on the 19th, and it will be here at the church. We'll start off with a fellowship lunch that we're providing. Really not like a potluck or anything. We're gonna provide the meal for you. And we would like to know if you're planning on coming. So if you could just text into our church office that you will be here and how many in your family, and that will be good. And I promise you there's good things in our business meeting that will make it worthwhile for you to come. And so we're looking forward to that next Sunday, 2 o'clock, and then 3 o'clock for a business meeting. And we want each of those things to be 1 hour. We don't want to go over an hour. If you want to talk afterwards, after we dismiss, welcome, and we'll stay by and talk with you. But that's the plan here for next Sunday. All right. So you can see in the bulletin a big thank you for the International Food Fair. That went fabulous. They earned great money for the Pathfinder International Camporee in Wyoming in this summer. And so that's going to be, or 2024, sorry. And so that will be great experience for our young people. And next Sabbath, by the way, speaking of food too, is that next Sabbath is our regular fellowship lunch. And I don't know if Mrs. Purvis wants to come up and talk about it, but I can. But the kindergarten roundup is this next week, and we'd like to give you that opportunity to share.
Good morning, church. It's so good to see you today. I am excited to be here. And as Pastor said, this coming Friday, the 17th, we're having our kindergarten roundup. And this is, as it says, just for kindergartners. They must be 5 by September 30. And we want them to come at 10 o'clock. We've got different activities planned. We want them to be familiar with the school, the teachers, the classrooms. We're going to have some fun things for them to do, and then lunch as well. So if you have a child in your family ready for kindergarten, or you know someone that is, please give them the word about our roundup day. We're looking forward to it. We've already got our teachers and our classroom set, everything for next year, and we're very excited about the coming year. So please help and support our kindergarten roundup. While I'm up here, can I say something else too? Good.
So long as it's not over 30 minutes.
Oh, good. Okay, so we have begun our re-registration. So if you're already a student at Mayfair, or someone in your family is, we are providing the month of February as a first opportunity for students who are already there to re-register for next year. And then on the 1st of March, we're going to have an open enrollment for everyone. We are already getting a number of calls, and so we want to encourage those who are already there and would like to come back to go ahead and do their re-registration this month. All right, and I want to say I'm so excited about some other good news that happened here in the last couple of weeks. I've been trying to work on getting some laptops for the 7th and 8th grade classroom. And lo and behold, this email comes about a grant that had been given to the school many years ago, and they wanted an update. And it's a long story, but to make it short, I thought we were just going to have to return the money because it was never used. And they said, no, do you need it for technology? And I said, absolutely. So we are now going to be able to purchase a laptop, 25 of them for the 7th and 8th grade class. Isn't that a wonderful answer to prayer? I'm so excited about that. And that grant came into us from VersaCare. So anyway, God is blessing. We've certainly had our challenges, but He is blessing. Good things are happening. And we just so much appreciate your support and your prayers as we continue to work with God's children and prepare them for not just life here, but you know, as it says, life for heaven eternally. All right. Okay.
I just want to say another word about kindergarten roundup. I've told Christine Haddix that if I had a child that was ready for kindergarten, I would want them to go to her class because she is so dedicated. She works hours and hours and hours and does all she can. And when I visit the class every week and I have story with the children, that is so cool. It is so much fun with those little children. And so there's a great environment there. And if you know somebody that is ready for kindergarten for next year, we will help them with the, there's Ohio Ed Choice that will really help out a lot. In financial structure and so forth. So we'd look forward to that for them being out on the kindergarten roundup. And of course, you could call Mrs. Purvis over at the school and get any information you need. It's now time for our prayer, and so I want to ask God's presence here this morning. Gracious Lord, we have come here to worship. We come here because our heart is needy. And we know that without you, our hearts are broken and cannot be fixed. But with you, all things are possible, and you are in the business of mending hearts and making them whole. Bless us in this service. As we come close to you, as we desire to exalt you and glorify you and praise you, bless in this service now, in Jesus' name, amen.
2 Corinthians 4, verse 7. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. We are hard pressed on every side, yet not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. Will your anchor hold? 5, 3, 4.
When the breakers tell that the reef is near.
Amen. Our next song is He Hideth My Soul, 520.
Yeah.
with his hands. When clothed in his brightness, transported I rise to meet him in clouds of the sky. His perfect salvation, his wonderful love, I'll shout with a million on high. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the law, that shadows are dry can still lend. He hideth my life in the depths of his love, and covers me there with his hand.
And offers actually a lot. It's an app. Oh, there you go. Thank you. 3ABN's an app. You can actually, on any smart TV, you can download. And what's great about it has a lot of resources for kids, for the health ministry. And not only that, you can have like different like preachers you can have on there. And my experience with that is my favorite one is probably the Mark Finley Revelations, Ancient Discoveries. It goes over the whole thing of Revelation. What I love most about this is if you're ever asking to like share it with somebody and you get into an argument, a topic where you don't really fully explain it in a 20-minute conversation, what you can do is reference them to these things. And I've gotten to several like arguments with people, but it's like a video argument. He sends me a video, I send him one back, and you can actually, it's a way, great way of actually ministering to people without actually sitting down and Bible studying. And it's a great way of getting into somebody's homes on a daily basis where you can't be there all the time. But if you have them download the app, you know, just 3ABN, it pops up on their screen. They scroll past Netflix. They scroll past HBO. And there's 3ABN. It's a way where you can be in the home without actually being there all the time. And that's really what I love most about it. So that's my little story on it. Will the deacons please stand? All right, let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for all the Adventist resources we have, especially the TV ministries and the 3ABN network. And help us to offering not only go to it, but help us to bless us and help us to use it and really get the word out and try to spread the message as much as we possibly can. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you.
Sorry about that. We practiced for a different song and we played a different one, but we thank God.
So I wanted to let you know we've had our prayer surveys filled out and we received responses. And one of the things that we intend on doing as a result of that is that in the next few weeks we're going to start a thing where we'll have an elder or one of the leaders of the church on one side and a lady in our church, and it could be an elderette or what, or somebody in leadership in our church, on either side at the close of the service. And at the close of the service, if you want to have prayer with somebody, if you'd like to have a time for you need to have prayer, we want to have that available for you, and we'll do that at the close of the service. It's now time for a children's story, and in our children's story we have today the puppets, and I know you get a blessing out of it, and so children, come on forward and bring an offering for Mayfair Christian School.
Hey, did you get your mom a Valentine's card?
I sure did, but before long, she was bugging me to clean up my room and make my bed. She says she corrects me because she loves me. Isn't that crazy?
Hey, I've heard your mom yelling at you. She must really love you.
Yeah.
But think about it. Even when you do wrong things and don't always obey her, she's always there for you. She loves you no matter what, kind of like how God loves you. He knew exactly what you were like, and he came to die for you anyway.
Yeah, maybe love isn't so crazy after all.
Your mom just wants you to know right from wrong, and to learn how to take care of yourself and your stuff. And remember, everyone needs love, even your mom.
There's three little words that everyone likes to hear. There's three little words that fill every heart with cheer. There's three little words that make the world go round and round and round. Those three little words are simply I love you.
That dads like to hear. There's three little words that'll fill their hearts with cheer. There's three little words that'll make their world go round and round and round. Those three little words are simply I love you.
There's three little words that'll make
Give your mom and dad a big hug and tell them you love them on Valentine's and every day. And don't forget to thank God for his amazing love gift of Jesus. You can go back to your seats now.
It is now time to worship God in prayer. I would like to point you to our prayer list in our bulletin. First, we need to remember Safari. Remember our friend Safari, who recently lost his brother in genocide over in the Congo. So we need to remember him. Pray for strength for him. Also on our list, we have Don Drury. He's in need of a liver transplant. Understand that he has recently been moved to Autumnwood Nursing and Rehab Center in Richmond. This is also the place where Fred Brady is now living. So if you go to visit one of them there, you can stop and see them both. We also want to pray for Lucky Menester. Lucky wants to thank each of you for the prayers that have been given to him. Recently, he had a severe incident while he was having dialysis, and he was taken to the hospital over in Ravenna. And he told me that the paramedics told him after it was over that when he got to the hospital, he was dead on arrival. So he is very thankful for the prayers, says that he has felt the prayers that our church has been sending up for him, and he thanks each one of you. Remember again Scott Michael Bennett, the musician who was recently in an auto accident, is now home and rehabbing. Again, we want to pray for Dick Gray. He recently had back surgery. Ekuse, who also had back surgery. I want to pray for Norma Imataglio's back pain. Catherine Caldwell, who is a lady who is suffering from terminal cancer. She is in her early 40s and has three young girls. I want to pray for them in that situation. Also pray for Doug Suglio's healing and health for him as well. I invite you to kneel with me as far as possible as we seek God in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we stop now to thank you for who you are, the Creator God, the one who has given us life. We humbly come before you and offer our praise to you. We thank you for the grace and the mercy that you've given to each of us, that first and foremost, through your Son Jesus, who willingly died that we may live with you. We thank you for the opportunities that you give to us over and over to draw close to you. We look around us and we see so much suffering. We think of our church family here that we have just mentioned, the suffering that is there. We pray for each one of them, give them healing, whether it may be from an accident or illness or cancer. We pray that you will be with them to give them peace, give them courage, give them strength. May they know that you are there at their side, being with them. We think of our church family as a whole. We pray for your presence in each family. We think of those who we mentioned this morning in need of prayer, that you'll be with them. Draw them close to you. We ask that you'll touch each one mentioned. Think of our church school this morning and the lives and families that are represented there, the students. We pray for them that your love will be known, made known to them, and that they will experience who you are and your love through their experience at Mayfair. Bless the teachers, we ask. We pray for your guidance there. As we prepare now for our service this morning, we ask that you will be present here. We invite you to come into our midst, into our room, into our hearts. We pray that there will be a willing place for your spirit and your love. May we, as we leave this place later, that we will be a witness to your love, and may others know who you are by seeing us and talking to us, we pray. We ask for your blessing over our pastor as he brings your word to us today. Give us words that will touch each of us. We pray that you'll give us ears to hear and minds and hearts to receive what the message that you have for us. We ask all of these things now in your name. Amen.
Days. Life carried me along. In my soul I yearn to follow God, but knew I'd never be so strong. I looked hard at this world to learn how heaven could begin, just to end where I began, where human effort is all in vain. Were it not for grace, I can't tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me. I know how that would go. Battles I would face, forever running but losing the race, were it not for grace. So here is all my praise, expressed with all my heart, offered to a friend who took my place and ran a course I could not start. And when he saw in full just how much his love would cost, he still went the final mile between me and heaven, so I would not be lost. Were it not for grace, I can't tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me, I know how that would go. The battles I would face, forever running but losing the race, were it not for grace. Forever running but losing the race, were it not for grace.
So, guys, I need your attention for a second. There's, for most of you guys, there's something special coming up this week. It's called Valentine's Day. And it would be a good idea to do something really nice for your wife. I mean, you could take her out, get a bite to eat. You could get some flowers for her. Might get her favorite chocolates, or all three of those, or even more. So that would be really nice to do that. Just saying. Okay. A few months ago, Jan and I watched a movie called The Most Reluctant Convert, The Untold Story of C.S. Lewis. Most people know C.S. Lewis for his best-selling work, The Chronicles of Narnia. In this movie, we got a glimpse of his remarkable life journey and the circumstances that preceded C.S. Lewis accepting Christianity. The opening scene begins during his childhood, and it led to the tragic death of his mother when he was only 9 years old, and then the stern distance of his father, which led him away from Christianity. In his late teens, he was drafted into the army and struggled through the reality of being on the front line, where he lost most of his closest friends during World War I. The nightmare trenches that he experienced burned in his memory and exposed to him a very cruel world that up to that point he had not yet known. And those events pushed him all the more into atheism. After being accepted into Oxford University, he began studies in English literature, and in 1929, he was accepted on the staff, the faculty, at Oxford University. Some of you may know who J.R.R. Tolkien was. He wrote the book The Lord of the Rings and several other books like that. They were bestsellers in the world for a number of years. But J.R.R. and Lewis became good friends in college, lifelong friends, in fact. And God used Tolkien to challenge C.S. Lewis on his beliefs. In fact, God used a lot of avenues to draw C.S. Lewis in. And the movie, The Most Reluctant Convert, brings to life the spiritual awakening of one of the 20th century's sharpest and keenest minds. In the movie, C.S. Lewis himself tells about the very moment of his conversion. He says, "You must picture me alone in that room in Oxford, night after night, feeling whenever my mind lifted, even for a second, from my work, the steady, unrelenting approach of him who I so earnestly desired not to meet, that which I greatly feared had at last come upon me." In the spring of 1929, I gave in, he says. and I admitted that God was God and knelt and prayed, and perhaps that night I was the most dejected and reluctant convert in all of England. I did not then see what is now the most shining and obvious thing, the divine humility, which will accept a convert even on such terms. The prodigal son at least walked home on his own feet, but who can duly adore that love which will open the high gates to the prodigal who is brought in kicking and struggling and resentful and darting his eyes in every direction for a chance to escape? That's the God I came to know. If you haven't had a chance to see the movie, it is very well done. It is just an engaging movie. Very, very good. But I want to say C.S. Lewis is speaking for us all. There are times when we come to God reluctantly. There are times when we return to God with hesitation, when we reluctantly keep God as the center of our lives. We at times go through a lot of difficulty. Is that not true? Well, I heard it, one amen. Some of you are not being honest with me here. Who can help but adore the divine humility that receives the reluctant, conscience-stricken people with joyful enthusiasm? And that would be our God. If we hesitate, if we hold back, if we at all are making movement toward God, He will more than meet us halfway. He is always willing to accept His children back to Him, and even though it is not perfect, He's working all the time behind the scenes to draw us to Him. God is more ready to meet us than oftentimes we're ready to meet Him. And so this week we continue searching the pages of Isaiah for gems from God's treasure house. And so today we turn to Isaiah chapter 33, Isaiah 33. And it comes from a setting where God's people are turning back to Him, because we have seen a litany of time after time God's people are turning away from Him back in the day. And now they're turning back to Him, but if you really study it out, not for the right reasons, not for the right motives. Because, to be honest, it was their last resort. Repentance was not their way of life. It was a last-ditch effort to stave off disaster. But nevertheless, God humbly received them anyway, and He didn't have to do it. He didn't have to do it, but because He loves us, because in His heart we are His children, and He hates to let His children suffer, and He will go to any extent to receive His children. And that's what God is all about. We have seen the Assyrian Empire threaten Judah in the last few weeks. We've also have seen how God has promised to help His children, people, bearing with them long, patient, understanding, forbearing, caring. But they were stubborn. And instead of turning to God, they went down to Egypt for help. It was a very costly venture, because over time, Judah came to realize that all the promise of help that Egypt was going to give them drained their bank accounts to a great degree, and there was no help coming from Egypt. They would not come to Judah's rescue. And so Assyria kept on pushing, coming, reaching, grabbing, nipping at the heels of the children of Israel. And the story in 2 Kings, it tells us how King Hezekiah tried to buy the Assyrians off. I mean, he was like trying to figure out what is the best thing to do. He withdrew money from the temple treasury. He stripped the gold off the doors of the temple and handed these sacred resources over to the king of Assyria. He wanted them, Assyrians, to leave his people alone. So imagine this scene. The hordes of the Assyrian army are surrounding Jerusalem. Read about it in Isaiah. Filling the landscape out to the horizon. The officials of Judah stood there high up on the city wall, looking out, watching nervously as the chest filled with gold and silver, because they drug out everything to give to the Assyrians, and carried out on the carts through the city gates to the Assyrian commander off in the distance. This they hoped would buy them, get them to turn away, to give them relief, to take away their fear. But I got to tell you, it must have been very humiliating to Judah, to the people of Judah, to Hezekiah, the king. But truth be told, it was doubly dishonoring to God. Because they had opportunity, and this wasn't the first one, as I just mentioned, opportunity time after time to come to God. Because God was willing to help them, but they didn't want that kind of help. They wanted to do it their way. And whenever we do it our way, it's when we get into trouble big time. In essence, it was like this. His people, God's people, treated God as a worthless ally. And then made him pay the bill for their disloyalty. I mean, that's what it, in essence, it turned out to be. They didn't see it that way. They surely didn't see it that way. But they saw that God was going to give them hope that finally something could happen here. And they had come to rock bottom. They have tried everything they knew how. And just as we do this day, because oftentimes when God is trying to get something across to us and we treasure this something that he wants to get to in our heart, and we cover it and we hide it and we hold it back, and God has to take us through some tough times often just so that we will come to wit's end and open our heart and allow him to come in. And that's exactly what was happening to Judah. Judah dreamed that the Assyrians would leave them alone, that this would soon all be over. So they take God's money out of the treasuries of Judah. They take God's honor and not living up to the name of God. And so there goes their integrity in the form of a payment to the Assyrian mafia. But as they watch from the wall, waiting for the foreign army to pack up their weapons, to disassemble their battering rams, to fold up their tents, the leaders of Judah began to realize the Assyrians weren't going anywhere. They may as well flush that money down the toilet, because it didn't amount to anything in their favor. It was a double cross. Assyria had planned to attack even after the money had come through, even after all the gold came through. And so Judah now realized they had just made a bargain with the devil. And something jolted them awake in that process. As the truth dawned on them, they finally realized, oops, we've blown it. We've miscalculated. We've done everything wrong. Our whole strategy has been wrong. We've offended God. We've weakened ourselves and gained nothing in the deal. And how true this is with people who are running away from God, who are reluctant to open themselves to God. And so here they finally realize that after all their very best intelligent plans, all their strategies and schemes, all their wheeling and dealing, they had nothing left but the grace of God. And that is a wonderful but. Nothing less but the grace of God. And I tell you, it's worth losing everything if we haven't seen, if we haven't understood the grace of God. If we get that, if we see that, if we realize that, then we are rich indeed. That really is what it all boils down to. And so God will go to any length to help us to get there, to help us to realize it's not about me. It's not about any of us. It's about Him, and it's about opening ourselves to His leading. They honestly couldn't tell Him that they valued Him at that point as the one from whom all blessings flow. They couldn't tell Him that because they had fought with Him for so long. And because in truth, they only valued Him as their backup plan. But listen, and this is the great news. After all that, God was still willing to receive them. And I don't care where you are in life. I don't care what has happened to you, what you have done, where you have taken your journey, and you may have turned your back on God. As long as there's something inside of you that will allow you to turn back and open yourself to the possibilities of God, God is going to be right there for you. And that will be until your dying breath. This is such a beautiful message that we have for the world today. We have such a beautiful message that God's love cannot be conquered. And it's only us who can remove ourselves away from God. And so He calls us to Him. He calls us to lead Him. So here's the setting that we find in Isaiah 33. And what Isaiah reveals here is God's answer to people who have wandered far from Him. So what does God say to people who have failed Him? Have you ever failed God? Well, I think we all have. I think we all have messed up, and we mess up all the time. And it may not be in the great big things, but sometimes it's the little things that go almost imperceptibly in our minds, in our hearts, in our thinking, and we think, oh, that's not that bad. That's not a big deal. But those little things, after a while, add up and become big things. And when those big things come in, where did that come from? How did I get to that point? And so every day, we're admonished to be students of this word and dig out the truths that God has for us in His word and to be seekers after His truth, because He will fill us anew every day, renewed every day. He has something for us every single day. So what is God's response to people who have failed Him and are just now only ready to hear, to get it? So again, Isaiah 33 is telling us that The mess we've made of our lives is the very place where God can and will meet our needs. The mess we have made, it's unfair to God because we make the mess. And God comes in and cleans it up. And God takes our life, and it may be upside down, it may be sideways, it may be going totally the wrong direction, and God will straighten it out. God isn't put off by the imbalance between our poor job of repentance and his overflowing grace. There is not a formula that we have. Some people call it the sinner's prayer. We have to go through a formula before we are accepted in Christ. I mean, there's people that do that every day and use that formula. And that's not the way God is. He's not, doesn't use man's formulas. What he wants is this word, the Bible, to become a living word inside of us, to where when we hear from God, it becomes a part of us. We open ourselves to him all the more because we see him in truth as he is. He accepts us even at a cost to himself, as long as we're willing to come. Isaiah 33, therefore, is for people who haven't been trusting God and recognize their life isn't working well without them, and they've come to the end of their rope. It's for people who are seeing in a new way that they can't treat God as a genie in a bottle and experience his presence and power that way, and they can't marginalize God and live a life with his blessing. In other words, oh, I do the God thing here, and I do the rest of my life over here. Doesn't work that way. We have put ourselves out of God's reach. It's not God who has pulled away from us. And we have not included God to be in our lives. When we do include God, he's all about that. And I believe that our hearts for the people in our church and our congregation really desire God to be in their hearts. Else you wouldn't come back week after week and let me talk to you like I'm talking to you. Because, you know, I have a heart for you and I have a heart for our church that we have it right before God. All right. Repentance does take us back to a practical trust in God. It pulls his blessing down upon us. It replaces our chronic impulses towards self-salvation. You know, we try to do it ourselves. We try to make it happen. And he replaces it with the peace that passes understanding. Okay, open your Bibles to Isaiah 33, verse 1. And we're going to look there for a few minutes. Isaiah 33, verse 1. Ah, you destroyer, who yourself have not been destroyed, you traitor, whom none has betrayed. When you have ceased to destroy, you will be destroyed. And when you have finished betraying, they will betray you. Now, who is Isaiah talking about here? Is it the people of Judah? He's talking about the people of Assyria. This is the last of five woes or five ahs to open this verse, in, as you see throughout the book of Isaiah so far. And he's always talking before about Judah. But now he's talking about Assyria, and this is how things change in Isaiah on the fly. And you've got to watch it and study it, and it'll get you deeper into the word, understanding the word and how it goes. And so, ah, you destroyer, Assyria. who yourself have not been destroyed. You're a traitor, who none have betrayed. When you, Assyria, have ceased to destroy, you will be destroyed. And when you have finished betraying, they will betray you. So this story where Assyria is surrounding Jerusalem, and they come and say, Sennacherib, our king, has told us to come down to you, and we want to take your money. And so King Hezekiah deliberates with his wise counselors, and instead of going to God, they start pulling money from the treasury once again. They tried it with Egypt, and Egypt was supposed to come and give military support to overcome Assyria, even if they could do that, they thought. But Egypt just took the money and ran. But now they're still faced with Assyria. Plan A didn't work. Now plan B, give money to Assyria. Well, it's better to give our money and lose our wealth than it is to be besieged and to be taken captive by this brutal nation. And the Assyrians were very brutal people. They didn't treat God's people with kindness at all. Assyria was all about destroying, double-crossing traitors who seemed to be getting away with everything, but in fact, they didn't know it, but they were doomed. And this is a cry in this verse, verse 1, of judgment coming upon them. Do you know what happened in the story as Isaiah brings it out? After them giving of their gold and their money out of the treasury, taking the gold off the doors of the temple, and in availing to nothing. And then Sennacherib sends his messenger back and starts taunting them. Who's going to deliver you now, people? You thought you were so smart. You think your God's going to deliver you? Well, God told us you're to be delivered to us. And so somebody shouted back, hey, speak in the language of Assyria, not in the language of the Judeans, because they are people understanding and they don't want to hear that. And they said, oh no, we're going to speak in the language of Judeans because we want everyone to tremble because we are coming after you guys. God is addressing them in verse 1 and telling them what is about to happen. And when Hezekiah recognizes what is about to take place, he is undone, he tears his clothes, and he gets the letters that were sent to him to the house of the Lord, and he kneels down and spreads these letters out before him. And he got, oh God, merciful God, we don't deserve your kindness. We have messed up. We have messed up royally. And we need your help. We're desperate for your help. Would you help us? And then Hezekiah, through Isaiah, got the word from God that God would indeed help them. And so when they came back another time, they came facing Hezekiah with a new air of peace in his heart. And God had given him assurance that they would win, and Isaiah took it to heart and ran with it. And so when that took place, when that went on, what happened next was, is there were armies in other parts of Judah that were conquering villages. And there was Sennacherib off in a distance. And his armies all of a sudden turned on each other, and 185,000 men were destroyed by the destroying angel one night. When that happened, Sennacherib ran back home. And he knew he was in trouble. How can you lose 185,000 men against the Judeans of all people? And he went back home. And they killed him as he was worshiping his false god. God knew what to do. God knew how to make things happen, how to turn things around. So God is addressing the Assyrian army, and so you know the rest of the story of what happened. And why is he doing this now, and why didn't he do it earlier? Because his people entered into a time of repentance. They've always called God their king, even when they were going after other gods and worshiping false images. But now, once again, they started to treat him, not just lip service, but treat him as their god. And so they began to repent. And the prophet gives voice to the people's change of heart towards God. Look at verse 2. Verse 2, O Lord, be gracious to us. We wait for you. Be our arm, our strength, every morning, our salvation in the time of trouble. Their tune has changed now, right? This is how trusting people speak to God. They say, the only thing between us and disaster is you, God. Our only hope is your strength moment by moment. Our needs are both constant and urgent, but by faith we lay hold of your endless grace as promised in your gospel. And we have this privilege today to meet that same God. And no matter what looms before you, no matter what challenges you face, no matter what difficulties that you have, it may be you're facing, and several of our people in our church have faced cancer, have faced all kind of terrible diseases and are facing right now. God's got it. You may be struggling financially. You may be struggling with family issues. There are a host of all different kinds of things, but God is bigger than all that. And he's worth putting our trust in, even when we don't see the way out of it. It's up to God to make the way for it to come, for it to work. And so this is how trusting people speak to God. The only thing between us and disaster is you. Our only hope is your strength, moment by moment. Our needs are both constant and urgent, but by faith we laid hold of your endless grace promised in the gospel. And so now we come to verse 3. The people look up to God in confidence. They see him in a new way, ruling decisively over everything that had been threatening them. And all of a sudden, we see here, verse 3. At the tumultuous noise, or of a roar, peoples flee. When you lift yourself up, in other words, God, when you lift yourself up, nations are scattered. And they saw the evidences of that. They see that all that he has to do to scatter the nations is just stand up. For us, if we try our devices, we try everything, we do everything we can, we struggle in every way we can, and there we exhaust ourselves, we're worn out, when it would be so easy, so beautiful to put our trust in God. Now verse 4. They look out to those nations. The "your" in this verse is plural, with boldness, and says, and your spoil, in other words, is gathered as all the caterpillar gathers, as locust leap is leapt upon. In other words, the power of evil will be stripped bare and enthusiastically looted And so what happened with the Assyrians? When God took out 185,000 soldiers, guess what Judah did? They went into their encampments and they had all these nice things that they could take home with them. All these things that they received at the hand of God, and they didn't do anything but turn to God for his help. Now verses 5 and 6, the people reaffirm that all they need is God. In other words, now they know that the key to life is a miracle, and by faith that miracle is becoming their miracle. Verse 5, the Lord is exalted, for he dwells on high. He will fill Zion with justice and righteousness, and he will be the stability of your times. Abundance of salvation, wisdom, and knowledge, and the fear of the Lord is Zion's treasure. The fear of the Lord is our treasure. Here's the point. So when we really trust God, lo and behold, we find he is there. He is really there. And he comes imperceptibly, and sometimes we're not sure where he is, but in the process, it may already happen, and we don't even realize it's happened. And it happens is that when God is the only one we're looking to. When we're looking to God as a byproduct of our need, that's not when we're going to see God working. God has got to be the only thing we're looking at, the only thing that we're seeing. And so this is how trusting God changes our experience of God. When we respect him enough to let him take control, he becomes the stability of our times. We need to take this home, this text home, and verse 6, he becomes the stability of our times, abundance of salvation, wisdom, and knowledge, because we are going to need this verse in the days ahead. Because things will come our way, and will come to hurt us, will come to cause us harm, will come to divide our families, to hurt our income, and we need to have an eye singular to God. And when we do that, God will do something remarkable. I enjoy watching people. I enjoy learning as I see characteristics and mannerisms. And it's been that way with me for a long time. And I want to go back to the time I was in college at Southwestern Adventist University when I was doing my undergraduate degree in religion. And so us future preachers had kind of a huddle of our own apart from the rest of the campus. And we had some very good teachers. In fact, this last year, went out to see one of my old teachers in his 90s now, and I think I mentioned it to you, just really a fine man of God. He spent the last 25-30 years of his ministry as the head of the Biblical Research Institute in the General Conference. It was a pleasure to see him again because I remember with fondness how he would bring Christ front and center. But so here you come, and I, like so many people, come straight away from a life without God to a life with God, and we want our lives to matter, and so we come and want to serve God in ministry because that seems appropriate, and that's what I sensed and felt a call from God to do, and so I was pursuing that. And as I was watching people there, there were interesting people, people of all sorts and backgrounds. But there are two that caught my interest especially. There was one young guy who really showed and displayed that he was all about God. He was living for God. He was sold out to God. And that's what it appeared to be. And in the process of time, he was very critical towards others. They weren't good enough. They didn't do good enough. And I remember when we had our homiletics class, which is preaching class, what Dr. Reed would do is he'd have the students to grade the people that were preaching. I don't know if he carried on that, but it was a disaster because this one guy, nobody was good enough. He would slam every single person. They weren't good enough. And interesting to note that as people looked up to him for a while, all of a sudden they got disenchanted because he was so hypercritical and judgmental. And it turned people off. Along comes another student, and this other student would come to class stoned. He came right out of the hippie movement, and he came to class, and you could smell that he had been smoking marijuana. And I'm thinking, wait a minute, here's this guy coming to be a minister, and I'm smelling marijuana on him. He's been smoking marijuana, and he comes to class. How can this, what is he doing here? He shouldn't be here. And so, year after year, in the 4 years in school, as we saw this guy, it was evident that God had something going with him. God was doing something in his life. And so his life changed. It wasn't people coming down and buttonholing him and telling him what he needed to do and didn't need to do. It was God working from the inside out. And here became a student who you saw an inward peace and a remarkable love for God. It should help us. We shouldn't be so judgmental of people. We shouldn't have our minds made up because God didn't have his mind made up. He saw this student as somebody of promise, and he went on to be a minister. And as far as I know, I haven't kept in touch with him over the years, he may still be a minister somewhere. How we see from the outside is so very different than what it is from the inside. How God sees from the inside, and his concern is how it looks on the outside. Because we, at times, want to show how godly we are. And really, on the inside, it's not that way. And so I praise God for that experience of seeing those two types of people that were in ministry. And one person left life in shambles. He left his wife. He left the church. He went out on a drinking tirade, and nobody has heard of him since. And so, who knows? God does, and we've got to put our trust in him. By wisdom and knowledge, it says here in verse 5 and 6, it's meant a conformity of heart and life to the revealed will of God. This is a wisdom inseparably connected with the fear of the Lord. If we have that connection. And this appears from verse 5 where it said, the Lord is exalted, for he dwells on high, and he will fill Zion. Or he will fill you and me. He will fill us with justice and righteousness. And he will be the stability of your times. He will be the stability of our times when a world is unstable. Abundance of salvation, wisdom and knowledge. The fear of the Lord is Zion's treasure. So if I lose everything, it doesn't matter. If I lose all my any worldly wealth that I may have, which isn't much, but if I lose that, it doesn't matter. But if I lose that connection with God, that heart for God, that love for God, that he wants to do, and I don't have a heart that is tender towards him and tender towards his people, then I've lost all riches that are worthy. I lost all things that are opposed to what God counts valuable. So the knowledge of which this text speaks is our security for his kingdom. The knowledge is thus described by the prophet Jeremiah. Thus says the Lord, let not the wise man boast in his wisdom. Let not the mighty man boast in his might. Let not the rich man boast in his riches. But let him who boast in this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord who practices steadfast love, justice, and righteousness in the earth. For in these things I delight, declares the Lord. This explanation leads our minds to God as reconciled to us in the Son of his love. For it is in Christ alone that the loving kindness of God has free scope for exercise towards fallen man, or indeed can be exercised at all, consistently with the demands of righteous judgment. And this is the knowledge alone which generates a bond in the heart of man that knits us to the heart of God. Keep it simple. Keep it basic. And no one else can give you these treasures. I can't give myself those treasures. I only can give myself to God. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we see you in the works of Isaiah and how you speak to us, how you speak to our times and our dilemmas. And we know that our culture, our society, our world is a floating mess that is not built on the foundation that counts. And we know that it is so important for us to be students of your word and to be right in your word, to hear your voice, because your voice is the only one that matters. And so we ask for your presence, Lord. We ask for your reminders. We ask that if we become reluctant, like C.S. Lewis was, that he would keep on working after us and chipping away until we open our heart and hear from you and walk in you and find that you are the God of our lives, the God of our hope, the God of salvation, now and evermore. And in the name of Jesus, everybody said, amen. Amen.
Our closing hymn is, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior. God is still in the business of mending us in our brokenness. 569. If you can all stand.
Pass me not, O gentle Savior. broken spirit, save me by thy grace. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. One on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Thou the spring of all my comfort, more than life for me. Whom have I on earth besides thee? Whom in heaven but thee? Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by.
Gracious Lord, for your mercy, your kindness, your long-suffering, your love for us, we trust and rest and depend on you. We ask your blessings now, that our hearts would be filled with your Spirit, and that we would not only be content to be filled in our hearts, but our lives would be poured out to others, and that out of us rivers of living water would flow to others, and you would bring many to knowledge of you. Bless us now, bless us this Sabbath afternoon, give us joy, and then on through the new week, watch over us and keep us until we come back again. And we give you the honor and glory, and thank you and praise you in the powerful, wonderful name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. God bless you. Have a great Sabbath afternoon.